Well, good morning and welcome to worship. It is good to be with you as we gather in the name of our rock, our fortress, our solid foundation, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome. That more and more of God's grace, His mercy, and His peace would be yours, to come to you, to be with you as you journey throughout your day and every day this week. Hey, we're going to start off worship this morning repeating responsively the words of hymn Psalm 46, which are going to guide our time together as we take a look at one of the most famous hymns of the church, specifically in our Lutheran tradition, as we take a look at that today. So these words are going to come up on the screen. I'll speak the leader part, and then together let us speak the all part. And so the words of Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. But be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Good words to be reminded that in the Lord there is a strength, there is a hope, there is a foundation that ours that comes from outside of us. A mighty fortress is our God. And so at this moment, let's take some time to share the peace of Jesus with one another. However you're watching this, if you're watching it on Facebook, drop some likes there. If you're watching this later in the day, take a moment, text some people in your community of faith. Share God's grace, His mercy, and His peace with someone else in the community of faith. And for you personally, the peace of the Lord, the grace of God be with you as His mercies are new yet for you again this morning. Peace of Jesus be with you.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Cause Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love, and my heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed.
is my salvation.
One more time.
Glory be to God the Father. Glory be to God the Son. Glory be to God the Spirit. The Lord is my salvation. The moon is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation.
And when I reach the final day, He will not
Songs of the Church. We're going to take a look today at an older song of the church, an older hymn of the church, one that's been around for almost 500 years, actually. A mighty fortress is our God. A mighty fortress is our God. Now, if you grew up in the Lutheran tradition, these are words that fire you up. When Reformation Sunday rolls around each year at the end of October, we know in the Lutheran tradition, we're going to be singing that one. This hymn is a strong one. The rhythm is intentional. The lyrics are strong. The melody is powerful. A mighty fortress is our God, has long thought to be the battle hymn of the Reformation. Because the spirit of the Reformation, what the church at large was being challenged at 500 years ago, over 500 years ago. It's a time where the church at large was being challenged to return to God's grace alone, God's word alone, and faith alone. Faith alone, word alone, grace alone. Those are the three pillars of the Reformation almost 500 years ago. And verse 1 of the hymn that Martin Luther writes almost 500 years ago goes like this. A mighty fortress is our God, a trusty shield and weapon. He helps us flee from every need that hath us now o'ertaken. The old evil foe now means deadly woe. Deep guile and great might are his dread arms in fight. On earth is not his equal. This is battle language, isn't it, in verse 1. I remember as a kid when we'd sing this song, this hymn in church, growing up, after singing the hymn, I remember feeling that, yeah, I am strong, I'm a mighty fortress now against the evils of this world in Jesus. I mean, you get done singing it and you're kind of fired up. What a great hymn, singing about the strength that we have in Jesus, the might that we have in Jesus, the courage alongside of our mighty fortress, who is our God. But I actually didn't learn until much later that when Martin Luther wrote this hymn in the 1520s, we think, the late 1520s, that the exact opposite of strength was his reality as he wrote this hymn. Martin Luther writes this hymn probably in the late 1520s. In August of 1527, a colleague of Martin Luther's was martyred, was killed because of his faith and his belief. The bubonic plague, which had already broken out in several other parts of Europe and Asia and Africa, had taken place. And depending on which historian that you read the statistics from, the bubonic plague up until that point had taken the lives of somewhere between 50 and 200 million people, which was somewhere between 25% and 60% of the population during that time. The bubonic plague, which had ravaged its way through Europe up until that point, it actually broke out in Wittenberg in 1527, which was the place that Martin Luther lived. In January of 1528, that next year, Luther writes about the deep anxiety and fear and terror and suffering and doubt that he was having, that he was feeling and living at the time. It was one of the deepest and darkest times of Martin Luther's life. In May of 1528, that same year as Martin Luther's kind of writing this stuff, his daughter Elizabeth, which had been born the prior December, she dies 5 months later in May of 1528. Martin Luther in his writings, as he talks in his writings about that time in his life, he uses this German word, Anfechtung, which usually gets translated like temptation or trial in the English, but it really communicates anxiety, fear, depression, worry, uncertainty, terror, just uncertainty with all of those emotions. Luther, he's in a deep, dark place in those years, one of the deepest and darkest times of his life. And so the point, Luther writes this hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, and then the words get put to music sometime later. But Luther writes these words in the midst of a time of uncertainty, of darkness, of grief, of sorrow, of anxiety, all of those emotions. And it's actually not a hymn of strength as Martin Luther's writing this hymn. It's actually a hymn that admits weakness. A mighty fortress is our God, because a mighty fortress I am not. A mighty fortress is our God, because I am neither mighty nor a fortress. A mighty fortress is our God, and I'm actually the opposite of whatever that is. Now, Luther's inspiration for the hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, comes out of the words of Psalm 46. And Psalm 46 reads this way: God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth give way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice and the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. But be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. The Lord of hosts, he is our fortress. He is with us. And the God of Jacob, he is our fortress. A mighty fortress is our God, because a mighty fortress we are not. It's actually a hymn out of humility, and it's a hymn that's written that the words are strong, the melody is strong. There's a great feeling when we get to the end, but it's a reminder in the strength of the song that our reality is something opposite. A mighty fortress is our God, because we're neither mighty nor a fortress. Our hope's got to be somewhere else. Our strength has to be somewhere else. Now, my favorite verse of this hymn goes something like this, and depending on which tradition you've grown up in and which hymnal that you use in worship, or which version of this the band plays and the worship environments that you've grown up in, it goes something like this. Though devils all the world should fill, all eager to devour us, we tremble not, we fear no ill, they should not overpower us. This world's prince may still scowl fierce as he will. He can harm us none. He's judged. The deed is done. One little word can fell him. One little word can fell him. That is the evil one and the evil that surrounds us and all that is our uncertainty and anxiety and worry. Luther has this great line at the end of that verse, one little word of Christ can fell all of that. And I remember growing up wondering, what is the one word that we can speak that will fell the evil one? There are some historians that think that Luther is referring to a specific little word in the verse of that hymn. In that specific word of Jesus, that Luther, he actually makes a big deal about that at a pastor's conference. And so some of those historians think that this moment in Luther's life gives rise to the end of this verse, and it goes something like this. Luther was at a pastor's conference once, debating with a theologian, Ulrich Zwingli, about what we really experience in the sacrament of Holy Communion. And Ulrich Zwingli, on the one side, was arguing that when we take the bread and the wine, we're simply receiving that, just the bread and wine, and that the bread and wine reminds us as a symbol of Jesus' body and blood, but it's not really Jesus' body and blood. Luther stands up, as the legend goes, and walks up to the chalkboard and writes four words down, "This is my body," and sits down without saying a word. Zwingli then stands back up to defend once again his position that in Holy Communion, the bread and the wine simply represent as a symbol the body and blood of Jesus. Zwingli sits down, Luther stands up, and as the legend goes, he walks up to the chalkboard and simply underlines one little word. And the word that Luther, as the legend goes, underlines is the word "is." And then Luther sits back down without saying anything. And so as the conference goes on, Luther and Zwingli, they debate back and forth, sort of. And at the end, as the legend goes, Zwingli had done all of the talking and Luther had said nothing. And all that remained on the chalkboard were those four words, "This is my body." And the word "is" had been underlined over and over and over and over. And the beauty, if it's true, the beauty of the legend of Luther at that pastor's conference is that he didn't say a word and instead let the words of Jesus speak for themselves. And that one little word "is" for Luther was such a powerful word. It's the words of Jesus. But as we think about the sacrament of the altar, as we think about Holy Communion, when Jesus says, "This is my body," for Luther and for the church, it's not simply a religious thing that we do to kind of check a box off. No, it's here when we hold on to the words of Christ, "This is my body, this is my blood," that one little word, that one little word "is," communicates to us what we receive in the Holy Sacrament. That is bread and wine for sure, but also the body and blood of Jesus. And for Luther, it was here at the sacrament of the altar that one little word, the word of Christ, the power and the promises of Jesus, as the sacrament makes its way into the life of the church, that the evil around us begins to fall away. Powerful. So is the word "is" that one little word that Luther is referring to in that verse in the hymn, "A Mighty Fortress"? Maybe. The broader point, I think, of probably what Martin Luther is referring to is when we hold on to the words of Jesus, we hold on to the words of Christ, whatever's going on around us, weak as we are, uncertain as the times are, anxious as we might be, as we hold on to the words and the promises of Jesus, a mighty fortress is our God, because a mighty fortress we are not. And so maybe that's a good reminder for you and for me, a word of encouragement for you and me today. When we're tempted to think that we got to kind of pull ourselves up on our own, when we're tempted to think that we have to be a mighty fortress, when we have to be strong, when we have to be courageous, when it's sort of on us to get through today, we're reminded in this hymn, in the words of Psalm 46, which have been the inspiration for this hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." There's a power from outside of us that is promised to us. A mighty fortress is our God. The Lord, our God, is our strength, and the God of Jacob is our fortress. So as we sing that hymn today, as we sing that song today, that you'd be reminded that there is a strength and a might and a power that comes from outside of you, that is the Lord your God. And in your baptism, the first moment you profess Jesus as Lord, he gave you his Spirit, his Holy Spirit, that as you sing the words, "A mighty fortress is our God," you're reminded, and I'm reminded, that we're kind of the opposite of whatever that is, and our strength is found in this one, our Lord Jesus Christ. So as we prepare to sing that song, let me pray over you and ask for an extra measure of God's grace, his mercy, his strength, and his might in your life as your mighty fortress. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are a mighty fortress, and as we talk about you as our rock, our cornerstone, the stone upon which all other stones are built. Last week, Pastor Sam talked about Ebenezer, that you are Ebenezer. You are the stone that is our helper. And today we talk about you as our mighty fortress, and as we sing the words "a mighty fortress," we are reminded that a mighty fortress we are not, that we are neither mighty nor a fortress. We look to you for our strength. And God, forgive us when we tend to turn inward for strength and convinced ourselves that it's on us. You promise us that there's a power and there's a might outside of us that you will give to us if we but ask. And so maybe as we sing the words to the hymn this morning, we're actually praying those words and asking for that strength once again that comes only from you. Lord God, we want to pray for a couple families right now in our community that are walking through the deep, dark valley that is the shadow of death. We want to pray for Bob Pullman's family, who went home to be with you, Bob did this past week. We want to pray also for the family of Loretta Kernu, long time ago members here at St. John's. Loretta went home to be with you this past week. And so as the families walk through just the deep, dark valley of the shadow of death, we pray that you are their mighty fortress, that you are granting them power and strength that's beyond what they're even aware of, and that the peace that passes all understanding might rest upon them today and in the days to come. God, we want to pray for those who are sick and suffering. We pray specifically this morning for Don, for Charlie, for Karen, for John, for Leslie, for Andrea and Logan. Pray for Esther. We pray for Barb, for Harold, for Rusty, for David, for Chelsea, for Terry, for Donna, for Wendy, for Irene, and for Bev. Lord Jesus, we pray that you bring healing to these individuals in your good and perfect timing. But beyond that, that they would know that you are the mighty fortress that is the power and strength for their lives. Lord, for all the uncertainty around us right now, for all the anxiety that's around us right now, for all the fear, the terror, for all of that that feels so often like it's pressing in. Again, as we sing the words "a mighty fortress" today, that we'd be reminded that we aren't, that we're exactly who we really are. We're weak and we're frail. But in you, we've got a strength that goes beyond our own. So we pray that you'd hear us as we pray together the prayer you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's sing.
A mighty fortress is our God. A bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood, a mortal is prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seen to work or swole, his craft and power great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. If we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is He, the Lord of hosts, His name, from age to age the same. And He must win the battle. And though this world with devils fill, should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed His truth to triumph through us. And though this world with devils fill, should threaten to undo us, for God hath will His truth to triumph through us. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? So we all proclaim and say,
mighty fortress. And once again, as we gather for worship, we gather not in the name of a God who is mysterious to us. He is mysterious, but He's also revealed Himself to us as one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So let's profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. If you need the words, they're coming up here on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen and amen. Hey, as we conclude our worship together, we want to do so by confessing our sins. We come before the Lord, acknowledging in his presence that we have fallen short of his glory, but we also do so in confidence that as we confess our sins, asking for mercy in the name of Jesus as we approach the throne of grace, that God will give that to us as we ask him for it. And so as we confess our sins this morning, we do so in the name of God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My brothers and sisters, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Well, in the mercy of Almighty God, our mighty fortress, Jesus Christ, was given to die for you, and for his sake, the Lord has forgiven you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so, as you head out into the week, for whatever that means, in the midst of uncertainty, hopefully not anxiety, but in the midst of the days we are living in, that you would know that in Jesus, there's a strength from outside of you. He is your mighty fortress, because we're the opposite of that, whatever that is. And so there's a strength for you and for me from outside of you and me, that God continues to be there for us. His promise is that he is with us until this age comes to a close. Just a couple things by way of announcements before we head on our way for the rest of the day. We had a couple of folks this past week, for the first time we heard, had not been receiving emails since we began that back in March. They weren't connected to our distribution list. And so as you hear that, from folks, please put them into contact with me or Pastor Sam or anybody in our office. That's important. We want to make sure folks are staying in touch and still connected to the body of Christ here in this place. So if you hear rumblings of that, you hear that conversation, please get them connected. We want to get them connected to make sure we're all staying together as we walk through these days. Secondly, for all you fellas, to be reminded of the golf outing that's coming up on September 18th. It's a Friday. It's going to begin at noon. Contact Pastor Sam in our office at sam@stjohnsop.com. That's sam@stjohnsop.com. Put your foursome together, and if you don't have a foursome, we'll get you in a foursome. That'll be a good time out, and then we will come back for dinner for some hot dogs here at church outside, distanced, of course, at 5:30. So it'll be a good opportunity for us to get together as brothers in the Lord for a time that day. September 18th, starting at noon, is the golf outing, and dinner's at 5:30. And so as you step into the week that the Lord has in store for you, receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Well, as the mighty fortress is with you, that the promises of Jesus are still good with all that's going on around us. God be with you as you step into the week ahead. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Did you feel the darkness tremble? All the saints join in one song. All the streams flow as one river. So wash away.